In this lecture today, I would like to present the proof of existence of solutions to the Einstein equations in a case where the initial data set has these T2 symmetries that I've been introducing last time, and also has solely the weak regularity conditions. So the setup is what we had last time here, and I will begin actually by reviewing quickly what I said at the last lecture, but adding a few more remarks that I had not given. So we begin with a Ricci flat, weakly regular T2 symmetric spacetime. I remind you that the topology is T3, so we are constructing a spacetime where each slice of the foliation will have the topology of T3. And what we have to do now, if we want to solve the Cauchy problem with some initial data set prescribed on one of these hypersurfaces, so what we have to do, we have to choose coordinates, right? We have to make a choice of coordinates that is going to simplify as much as possible our system of PDEs. And we will work with two systems of coordinates, one which is called conformal coordinates. They are essentially the so-called null coordinates that are often used for solving the Einstein equations. And another set of coordinates is called the real coordinates. It's based on the geometry of the specific problems that we have in mind, this problem with T2 symmetry. So it's also a very natural gauge to use. And in fact, the global results that we will prove will be stated and will be proven in the so-called real gauge, where the time function here is going to coincide with the area of the orbits of symmetry, which have T2 as a topology. So what we need to do today is go through these estimates. So there will be various energy estimates that we'll use as much as possible, I mean, all the structure of the PDEs. Some arguments of monotonicity, connection with the area, compactness properties, continuation principle, etc. Okay. So the outline is that. So I revisit what I said last time about the conformal gauge that we have already introduced, and then I will discuss the areal gauge. So this will be in a first section. So talk about the conformal gauge and the areal gauge. The second part will be a proof of the existence of weakly regular Cauchy developments. And this part will be done in a conformal gauge, and we will continue by moving to the areal coordinates, areal gauge, and we'll be able to understand the global, get a global foliation in areal gauge. Okay, and that's essentially what I want to cover for today. But if I have time, there are some additional remarks that I may also discuss in the end. And for instance, you know, proving uniqueness and geometric uniqueness for this problem. Okay, so here we are. We have conformal coordinates. I mean, we would like to construct conformal coordinates, and they are defined as in the screen, and I'm going to write the expression of the metric here. So the metric is going to be given in this form. So G is E 2 nu minus 2 P over R minus D tau squared plus D xi squared plus E 2P capital R, and then we have G plus AH D xi plus DX A DY to the square plus E minus 2P capital R H d xi plus dy square. So you can see that the unknowns in the matrix, the coefficients are denoted by P. They are P capital A capital R and U, right? So these will be coefficients that will solve a system of equations I will call the essential Einstein system. And then you will have two additional coefficients, capital G and capital H, which will be essentially decoupled. I mean, they will be decoupled from the rest, right? So very soon, they are not really going to play a role here. Okay, so the first proposition I have here is the existence of such coordinates when you start from admissible coordinates, which is what I had defined before. So these admissible coordinates give you global coordinates on your spacetime or your piece of spacetime. And the coordinate x and y correspond are in a sense adapted to the T2 symmetry. They describe the T2 orbits, and the conformal, the Cauchyan spacetime can be parametrized by tau and xi if you have these conformal coordinates. Okay, so this can be done in such a way that the hypersurface, the initial hypersurface that you had in your problem is kept by the coordinates. T equals T0 in the admissible coordinate coincide with tau equals tau 0 in the conformal coordinates. And so the main point of that, so doing a transformation like this is not very original. But in our case, we have to be careful when we do this transformation because of the regularity, the low regularity. And the regularity that we have here is the one which is stated here, the chart, tau xi xy and t theta xy. They are actually only W1 infinity compatible. Okay. So one expressed in terms of the other is only Lipschitz, continuous. In fact, a little bit more regular, but certainly not C infinity regular. Okay, so at every step, you have to be careful and make sure that the regularity is well described. So this part is something I already discussed last time, but maybe some of you were not here last time, so I will again go through it quickly. So we have a metric in this form. This is our form of admissible coordinates. And what we want to do, we want to establish the existence of two functions, tau and xi, so that the metric can take this conformal form. There is a change in the coefficient mu when you go from one form to the other form. So I have a notation nu here and nu hat there, and the relation will be given by a formula that will follow. And the objective for this argument is to construct null coordinates. So null coordinates are functions u and v of theta and t. They are going to be only Lipschitz continuous, and they satisfy these propagation equations, right? So rho is a coefficient that you have in your admissible coordinates, which I call the conformal coefficient. That this is a coefficient that characterizes the regularity of the metric, of the conformal metric. And in my case, it's only W21 in space. And bounded like this. So you need to solve this, right? You have rather low regularity. You impose some periodicity condition because we want to work on S1, and you look for maps U and V, which are diffeomorphism on its image of this map, and again it's only Lipschitz continuous. So of course, if you have done that, you just set tau is v plus u over 2, xi is v minus u over 2, and you check easily that you have the requirements that you wanted. And also, you can compute easily the relation between u and u hat, which appear in the expression of the metric in both coordinates, and they are related by just writing these relations. And they tell you that the coefficient nu and nu hat are related in this way, right? But of course, u theta, v theta have a limited regularity, so you have to be careful about tracking this regularity. If you have a regularity for nu, make sure that for nu hat, you keep the same regularity. The existence of these neural coordinates is simply done by imposing some value initially on the initial slice t0. You can essentially take whatever you want, but here I'm choosing that u on the initial slice is t0 minus theta and v is t0 plus theta. And one motivation to do that is that if you compute tau here, you see that you do get the slice, the initial slice is kept to be t0 in the new coordinates. And you denote by theta plus or minus the solution of the characteristic equations, right, with initial conditions theta. So you fix a theta, I mean the picture is just that. You have the initial line, and you are following two characteristics, one corresponding to speed rho, and one corresponding to the speed minus rho, and you start from some initial value, this is S1, you have some initial value theta, and you define theta plus and theta minus by following these characteristics, right? And these are the functions that are used to define the null coordinates. Since rho is Lipschitz continuous, you have a solution which is Lipschitz continuous. So it's just a standard ODE argument. And now you can look a little bit more at the regularity, what you have constructed, right? So you look at the variation, I mean the derivative of this theta plus or minus with respect to the base point. And of course you have this classical formula for exponential of this variation of the speed, rho theta. And now this is only L infinity, right? If you have Lipschitz continuity, you get something which is only bounded. So it may have jumps, if you like. What's important is that this never vanishes. And therefore, you have a diffeomorphism that you want, right? W1 infinity diffeomorphism. By uniqueness, you have the periodicity that you wanted. And eventually, finally, what you can do, you can define the null coordinates. So you wanted functions u of t and theta, and v of t and theta. And they are defined in this way, simply by saying that u is constant. So this statement means that u is a constant along the characteristics that leaves from the base point, which was theta in our notation. And in the same way here, v is constant along the other characteristic with a speed minus rho. So we have u and v, limited regularity, so there is some care to have here. And this is a point that I didn't make last time that I want to emphasize. If you write the metric in this original form in admissible coordinates and you compare with the metric in conformal coordinates, you have you can check how the regularity is preserved, right? So the transformation being W1 infinity, it's easy to see, so you do have these properties that u theta, v theta, ut, vt are bounded. And this is enough to claim that the regularity for p, so we had a p in these notations, so it's denoted, I mean, sometimes I denote this quantity p and at some other expression capital U because they differ by some expression of R. But R is more regular, so it doesn't really matter. So I have these two variables, which are H1. This is our regularity. And here I'm telling you that the regularity doesn't change if you have a map which is Lipschitz continuous. Right. That's rather clear. But concerning the coefficient nu, you have to be more careful because nu, in fact, nu was assumed to be W21. So this was part of our definition. By definition, weakly regular means that this nu has to be W21. Okay? But this regularity is preserved, but you have to check that. Is preserved because you look at this relation between nu and nu hat, and you use now not only that u theta and v theta are bounded, which was enough for the previous steps, but you now use that these quantities are W11 because they are actually u and v are W21 with respect to t and theta. And the proof of that uses that rho is W21, which is, again, our regularity for a weakly regular metric in admissible coordinates. And that's not difficult to check. If you compute two derivatives of theta of u, you get this identity here, where this first term is bounded and non-singular, so that doesn't pose any problem. And the second term is a second derivative with respect to theta. But we had already the first derivative, so if you compute the second derivative, one more derivative on top of this identity, and you look at now the L1 norm, not the subnorm as before, but the L1 norm, you see that the L1 norm of the second derivative is indeed bounded by the L1 norm of log of rho theta theta, right, which is finite. So you see that, everything fits well. You put some regularity assumption in your definition, you do a change of variable with limited regularity, but in fact you keep, what is good is that you keep the same weak regularity conditions. Okay, another point I didn't mention last time is the normalization of the twist constants. We defined the twist constant to be this quantity. So we had a formula in terms of nabla x and y, which was the two Killing fields in the spacetime. And then we transformed that in terms of the Christoffel symbols. And then we also computed the expression of this cx like this. So we found that cx was minus 2, this area function, this conformal coefficient times one of the Christoffel symbols. Which was only assumed to be L infinity, right? But we were able to show that T of Cx and Z of Cx, where Z was orthogonal to X and Y, so these quantities were zero. So what that means is that the quantities C sub X and C sub Y for a T2 symmetric spacetime are constants. These quantities are principally are functions, but they are actually constants. In T, in space and time. And there was also the observation that by a linear combination of the two Killing fields, you could make one of the two to be zero. Okay. So here I'm going to decide that Cy is normalized to be zero without any restriction. And I will define capital K to be the other twist constant. And if we like, we can also normalize this k to be positive, because you can always change x into minus x and get the other sign. Okay, I already mentioned that these so-called shift type coefficients are not very important, the g and h, and they will satisfy equations that are decoupled from the essential Einstein equations. Okay, and that's what we are going to see now. So the first line is the expression of the metric in conformal coordinates. And on the top here, I wrote the connection between capital P and capital U. So again, P and U are H1, and R is more regular. It's Lipschitz continuous. So we get that. We get four evolution equations. And I probably should write also this on somewhere on the blackboard. Maybe I can remove that. At least you should keep in mind the general structure, even if I don't write everything in details. But so the general structure is that there is a wave equation in conformal coordinates. There is a wave equation for u with some quadratic terms. We have also a similar wave equation for a, also with quadratic terms. And we have two more equations that have slightly different structure. I mean, they also contain the wave operator in conformal coordinates, so both for r and for nu. But now you have source terms that are a little bit different. I mean, for the area function, this is something of, I would say, of zero order, if you like. This is a term of zero order. And those were first order quadratic terms. And U somehow contains both types of terms. Now, I also wrote on the slide here, I also wrote, you know, which component you had to use from the Ricci curvature in order to get this equation. So the capital U equation comes from the Ricci XX component and YY and XY and ZZ components. So these are the components that give you the propagation equations from the big Einstein system. And then you have two constraint equations that were deduced from the capital T and TZ components. And they had this structure here. So I will return to that later. And these equations are satisfied in L1. So every term here is in fact a function. Right, so even the second derivative here can be checked to be a function. And for the twist quantities, we have two relations that tells you that capital K is a constant in psi, is a constant in tau. And you have two more equations which correspond to integrating the equation for the other twist quantity. Okay, so this is our system. We have four wave equations. We have two constraints. We have two constraints. And we have, like if you think of K being a constant, there is two more equations which you can think as simply as ODEs. Okay. So what we want to do? So we want to, maybe not immediately because I need to introduce the aerial coordinates first, but after that, we want to solve that, get a local existence result in the right spaces, and then extend the solution in gauge coordinates, in a real coordinates. Okay, so here we are. We need first to look at the aerial coordinates. So the time function is taken to be capital R, which is possible because nabla R is a time-like vector. And the regularity in these coordinates is in terms of this area function obviously will be very regular. So when you go to aerial coordinates, this equation is gone. You don't write it. And instead, you have an equation for the so-called conformal coefficient in the conformal metric. So you will see that in a second. The area function is more regular because that comes from the constraints. And you have this property, so the motivation to use that R as a time function comes from this property that the gradient of the area is a time-like vector. So if you compute its norm, it's negative. And I gave the proof of that last time. So I have a few remarks here to say that the regularity for the area comes from the two constraints, Ricci TT and Ricci TZ. From the evolution component Ricci XY, you can deduce that RTT is also L1. So you have this additional regularity. And the fact that the gradient is time-like allows you to use R as a time function, at least locally. But it doesn't say anything globally. But we will see that it's also useful globally. Okay. So now you want to see... let me skip this page because this is already something I explained. This is essentially the proof that nabla R is time-like. And what I want to show now is to show the field equations in aerial coordinates. So in aerial coordinates, you have this notation. So eta instead of nu, so pretty much like the change that I made going from capital P to capital U, I'm doing something similar for nu, and for nu I have a different notation if I use different coordinates. But again, the difference is just by a term which have more regularity. So in terms of regularity, the regularity of eta and nu should be the same, and capital P, capital U should be the same. Okay, we can prove that these aerial coordinates are admissible and the regularity holds, but there is a discussion that I will return to that in the end if I have time. But at this moment, take these coordinates as being a choice of admissible coordinates. So here's the metric now. So now the metric has a slightly different form. I should probably also keep it here. So now we have so now we have the metric in this form. So e to the power 2 eta minus u minus dr squared plus a minus 2 d theta squared. And the rest is pretty much the same. So 2 capital U g plus a h d theta plus dx plus a dy squared plus e minus 2 u r squared h d theta plus dy squared. Okay, so now what you have now, you have capital U, capital A, eta, and small a as the main unknowns, and capital G, capital H are some decoupled, more or less decoupled variables. The regularity in these variables is what you expect. So the first derivative in time of U and A and the first derivative in theta in space of U and A belongs to L2 in space, locally bounded in time. The derivative of eta belongs to L1 in space. G and H are only bounded. And the conformal coefficient A that comes here, which is the analog of the rho that we had in the admissible coordinates, belongs to W21 in space. Okay? And the time derivative of G and H are also bounded. Okay? So this is our level of regularity, and we need to be able to prove the existence of the Cauchy developments using only this regularity. Now, I write the equations. So the equations look maybe a little bit more ugly, but that's what they are. So you have now an A minus 1 or an A in front of an R derivative or a theta derivative. You have terms here that are like before quadratic in terms of first derivatives. The wave operator here is the same for capital U and capital A and eta, right? So you have the same wave operator on the left side. And on the right side, you have quadratic terms for the first two equations. And in the third equation, you have this term that looks a bit different, right? You have two time derivatives of this conformal coefficient weighted by r. But r is a variable now. R is just, it's as smooth as you want. And one more equation for this conformal coefficient, that the log of a r derivative is related to eta. So the whole system is coupled. The regularity is quite limited for the first three equations, and the last one holds in W11, in fact, because A is the W21. Now you have, of course, more equations. There are two constraints for giving you eta, theta, and eta sub r, again, with quadratic terms. Every term here belongs to L1 of S1. And you have the twist conditions. For capital K, they are very simple. And for capital G and capital H, they are pretty much similar, I mean, the same as before. Okay? So this is a system that we would like to study. And we will start by using conformal coordinates, right? Somehow the system looks simpler. But it cannot be used if you want to have a global information, global dynamics of your spacetime. So the outline of the proof is as follows. The first step is to realize that when you have smooth initial data, you can construct a local in time smooth solution. And I'm not going to do that. This is a classical system, hyperbolic, nonlinear hyperbolic system. So a standard fixed point argument will tell you that if the initial data set is smooth, then the solution will exist for a small time. So what I will do is to prove the local existence in conformal coordinates within the class, the weakly regular class that I want to study. And this is something we will do by finding a suitable compactness property in the right spaces and showing that the size, I mean the time of existence, can be controlled in terms of a natural norm of the initial data. Right? If you show that you have a solution but it depends on a very strong norm of the initial data, it would be irrelevant for us. Right? So the norm that you have for the size of the time interval should be controlled, should be controlled by a good norm from the initial data, a norm that is only using the regularity conditions that I have imposed. And so if we can do that, we'll be able to move to the local existence in real coordinates, and essentially we can translate the local existence in conformal coordinates, translate it within these real coordinates. We arrange that the initial hypersurface coincide with the initial hypersurface with the other coordinates, and we observe that r is strictly increasing in terms of tau, because nabla r is timelike, and we normalize, so we are going to normalize the area to be increasing toward the future, and of course to be decreasing if you go towards the past. But this is only a normalization, so you know that it's monotone, and you can normalize the time direction so that r is strictly increasing for tau strictly increasing. And therefore you can transform a weak solution to the conformal Einstein system to a weak solution to the real Einstein system. So the two systems that I mentioned here. Right? So you can go from one to the other. If you have a solution locally defined, you get a solution in the other system, which is also locally defined, but it's another set of coordinates. And the main point is that the weak regularity is preserved. Right? So I have only partially explained why this is so. If I have time, in the end, I have a few more pages to make this part more rigorous. But this is a property. And then the next step will be to analyze the global and the causal geometry in real coordinates. And that's something we will mostly do in chapter 5. I may say a few words at the end of this chapter, but mostly I keep this for chapter 5. Where we will see that not only r can go to plus infinity in the future direction, so that's what we will need to discuss. If we have this this foliation in terms of r, you would like to show that r goes to plus infinity if you go to the future, and r goes to zero if you go to the past. Okay, and these properties are true except for some exceptional spacetimes, and I will discuss that but later. So we are here now. We would like to do the local theory in conformal coordinates, right? So we fix a weakly regularity to symmetric initial data set. So sigma, it has a topology of T3. We have a metric, we have a second fundamental form with weak regularity, so essentially H1, described in some admissible coordinates. And we make two assumptions. We assume that the data are non-flat initially, which of course is not a big restriction, otherwise it's just a trivial case. And if they are not flat, we know by a previous lemma about the gradient of the area function that this quantity is non-zero, this quantity here. Right? So this is a time derivative minus a space derivative. I mean, this is given by the initial data set, but that's essentially what it is. This is what plays the role of the gradient, of the norm of the gradient, which we assume to be this quantity to be non-zero, and more than that, we look at the infimum of this quantity, okay, or the infimum of each part of the product. So the product, of course, defines the norm, the Lorentzian norm of nabla r, and what I'm taking here, I'm taking some stricter definition, if you like, where each of the factor is you take the infimum. Now, the second assumption I'm making here is to normalize the data to be future expanding. So it's not really an assumption, but it's a normalization. And I'm assuming that I have this sign when I will go to the future. In terms of our coordinates, in coordinates and in terms of the initial data set, we already derived this this formula before, so it means something very concrete in terms of the initial data set that you have in hand. And the result here is that there exists a Ricci flat weakly regular T2 symmetry Lorentzian manifold, which can be described with a global chart of admissible conformal coordinates, where your manifold is an interval cross T3. This interval is tau 0, this is our initial slice, to to some tau 1. And G is expressed in the conformal form that I described before, where R is strictly increasing with tau. And so this is the main point, somehow, of this statement. The main point is that how big is this, is the time of existence, right? And so the time of existence is at least it is controlled by this quantity, which is maybe a complicated expression, but it only involves natural norms that you can produce from the initial data set. Right? So you have assumed that capital U, capital A, belongs to H1, so I take this as a part of my norm. You also had that the time derivatives, or more precisely, I mean, this is what comes from the second fundamental form that you have prescribed in your initial data set. This has been assumed to be L2, so I also take this in my norm. And then U bar is W11. What plays the role of the time derivative is L1. The area is W21. The corresponding time derivative is W11. And I have also, so two more quantities here, which are important if you want to close the arguments. So one quantity is 1 over R. So it tells you how far you are from R being 0, right, from the crushing point here. So I want to start at some finite R and move to the future, right? So that's what I will do here. So my norm here, if I am very close to R equals 0, of course, will be very big. But at this moment, that's not the part I'm concerned with. But yet, I need to include that in the norm if you want to close the arguments that I will show. And one more quantity, which is as much important, 1 over M0, where M0 is this quantity here. Okay? So you can imagine that when this quantity is very small, it's a rather singular situation. So also, you want to avoid that and to measure your norm in terms of that. Your time will be very small. If M0 is very small, the time will be very small. If R initially is very small, in the same way, the time will be very small. Okay. The regularity is the one I stated before. So the only thing new here is that I've specified a regularity in time. So C0, C1, C1, C0, C1, C0, C1. And this regularity is something, again, if I have time, I will tell you how it comes, but it's not assumed in the definition of weak regularity, but it's proven by using the Einstein equations. And somehow this is important. I mean, you would like, intuitively, you would like to know that in time, what you are constructing is not completely crazy and the solution doesn't jump in time in an uncontrollable way. So this regularity is important for the interpretation of the result, and it's also important for the proof. If you want to close the estimates, the energy estimates I will show, you need that. And of course, you also need a few to specify the initial data set, how it is assumed. And so you need to have an embedding here so that the initial data set is satisfied in this sense. At this moment, I'm not saying anything about the uniqueness, but this is something that we can address. And again, this is postponed to the end. If I have time, I will talk about that. Okay, so we can now proceed with the proof. The proof will work like this. We will first regularize the initial data set. Okay, and I will actually explain in two or three pages how you do that, how you go from an initial data set which has this low regularity to something smooth. And then I will derive a priori estimates for sufficiently regular solutions. I will be in that situation if I have a regularized initial data set. And what will be next needed is to prove, of course, the compactness property of the solutions. Right. So the smooth solutions will converge to the weakly regular solutions that I want. So so we are given a solution in conformal coordinates. I mean, we at some point we will have regularized or solve it with a classical result of existence. So we will know that there is a smooth solution defined in some interval of time. But of course, without any a priori any control of this time, tau 1, and the main goal will be to control this time of existence and show that the time of existence doesn't shrink to tau 0 when the, you know, you go from regularized initial data to weakly regular initial data. We assume that the spacetime is non-flat. We assume the time orientation R sub tau positive. And we derive these estimates. There will be a bootstrap argument that I will not elaborate on that. And I will only show the estimates. Right? But with the estimate that I will show, you can close the argument and show that these estimates are strong enough in order to control the time of existence. Right? But I think if I show the main estimates, this will be convincing enough for this lecture. And that's what I will do. But before, we need to look at the regularization of the initial data set. So I will spend a little time to tell you about that. So for simplicity, I'm going to assume that the initial data set corresponds to a slice of constant area. But that's not strictly necessary, but for the presentation that's easier. And I would like to show that. I would like to show that if I have a weakly regular initial data set for the essential Einstein equations, so I just got rid of, I can get rid of capital G, capital H in this. So if I have an initial data set like that, I can find a sequence of smooth initial data sets. So the letters are the same, but I have added a subscript n, which will again satisfy the Einstein constraint equations and will be very smooth and will converge almost everywhere to the initial data set that I'm given here. Okay, and the conversion will be for u0, u1. So this refers to essentially to time or space derivatives, right? This 0 and 1 subscripts refer to that. I mean, again, this quantity comes from the second fundamental form, and these quantities are the space derivatives of your metric coefficient, of your data. Right? So that's what I mean by this. So this quantity will converge to what you want in L2. Right? And L2, this is consistent because I put a derivative here. So this quantity indeed belongs to L2 when A and U where in H1, these derivatives are in L2. So that's the right level of conversion that we want. I will also ensure that An converge to A in W21, and eta 0, eta 1 converge in L1. And again, this refers to time or space derivatives, so that's exactly the level of regularity that we are assuming. So the function gh, they do not appear because they are irrelevant for the constraint equations. And before I proceed with the proof of that, I would like to emphasize that the same argument I will present will actually show you that there exist weakly regular T2 symmetric initial data sets that have exactly the weak regularity that I propose, right? I mean, you could say maybe there is no, no such initial data set at this level of regularity. But in fact, by the same arguments, you can show that this set is not empty. Of course, there is something very smooth would, of course, be in this class. But something which is not smooth and has just the weak regularity that, that we impose, such initial data sets do exist. Okay, so we proceed by convolution of the data. We pick an arbitrary regularization of the data, U0, A0, U1, A1, A. Right? So I did not include eta 0, eta 1 in my list. So these are functions defined on S1, very smooth, just do that by convolution. So you can always find very smooth functions that will converge in L2 to this function that you have prescribed. And An will also converge to A in W21. Right? So I just do something by standard convolution, but only, of course, not for all components, because otherwise I would fail to satisfy the Einstein constraint equations. Right? So I do that only for these five quantities here. And then, of course, it remains to regularize eta 0, eta 1, so that the constraint equation hold. And I proceed in the following way. So I suppose that I have one of these regularized initial data set, and to it, I associate this quantity. So I look at this quantity, which was nothing but, probably if I show it, it would be more clear, but this is something that we had in the equation, one of our constraints in conformal coordinates. So let me return to it. Okay, I will get it from, let me see, from, sorry, actually I'm, yeah, actually I'm doing the regularization here in a real coordinates. Okay, and that's precisely why I made the assumption that the area was constant. Okay, so this argument of regularization can be done in both sets of coordinates. But at this moment here, I want to do it in a real coordinates, right? So maybe it's a little bit illogical because I want to work in conformal coordinates, but otherwise it would be quite messy in terms of calculations. Okay, so think of doing the areal coordinates description, which is on the screen, and what you want is to have to satisfy your Einstein constraints, and in fact these are the main two equations, right? So I want to work with that, and what I will do, I will so I want to make a regularization so that this equation is preserved. So eta theta is capital R, and then 2 ur u theta plus 2 r minus 2 a capital R a theta. Okay? So keep this in mind, and then you can understand what I'm doing now. What I'm doing now, so I regularize all the variables except eta. And to handle eta 0, eta 1, I look at this constraint equation, and I defined, and I look at the quantity which is on the right side, on the blackboard. I put an n, right, on it, and I call this quantity lambda of my initial data set, regularized one. And then I integrate, right? So of course, because S1 is periodic, I should get zero if everything was well, for the exact initial data set, I do get zero. But of course, I don't get zero at this moment because of this regularization. Okay? Okay. So you just have to understand how to make this capital lambda to be zero, which would give you the right periodicity condition. Okay, so this is what you see. So if you look at this quantity here, this quantity lambda will converge to the eta 1 bar quantity, right? According to the equation on the blackboard. This sequence by periodicity should go to zero. And again, eta is what I said, special derivative of a periodic function on S1. Okay. So how you do that, right? You have a regularized function that does not satisfy your constraint, and so you have to modify it in a certain way. And this is what I want to explain here. If you are able to satisfy that this lambda of yn is zero, okay, that's maybe not necessarily the case yet, then of course you can define eta n in the following way. you fix an arbitrary theta point theta star in S1, and you simply integrate, right? Because this plays the role of the theta derivative. So if you just integrate, you expect to recover eta from its theta derivative. And that's what you will call eta bar n, right? A regularization. And this is a formula that is defined where on this side I have put the regularization quantity, the regularized quantity here. I integrate that, then I recover an eta, and eta has the right property if the average is zero, right? Which I'm at this moment assuming. If this average is zero, I define eta by this formula, and I realize that the convergent is in the right space, W11, because this quantity involves square of first derivative of function that were in H1. So this is certainly in the right space, L1. You have integrate once, so if you differentiate this, you will get something in L1. So this is the right space, W11, and the convergence holds in the space that that you want, right? And now you do something similar for the time derivative, eta 0 n, that you recover by the other equation, okay? And you check that everything goes well with this. But of course, I have made an assumption here that is not explained yet, which is that this average of my regularized initial data set is zero, but that may not be the case. So let me skip maybe the details of the convergence argument here. But this lambda is not zero. Okay, so I mean, if you really want to go and to see all the details, you have to be careful about the convergence of that. I mean, so okay, so if you check all the spaces that are involved, you do see that under this very strong assumption, you do satisfy the two Einstein constraints. Okay, but the main point I want to make is that you can indeed obtain a regularization for which this average is zero. And we proceed in the following way. You start with a regularized set that may not satisfy the constraints. And so there is the discussion that, you know, I'm basically working with this quantity, and I observe that this quantity doesn't have an average which is zero. So how can I modify one of these? Now, these have been regularized, but they have been regularized in a way. So I may not be able to define this because this is not theta derivative, right? So just like that, right? So I need to make a modification. And I make the modification by I distinguish between two cases. So if this average is the average of U1 square and UA square are both zero, I will do something. I mean, I would say it's basically trivial. And when they are not zero, I'm going to be able to modify this initial data set. Okay. So so this case, of course, is easy because if these averages are zero, it just means that U bar, A bar, because this means these are theta derivatives, they are constants. And if they are constant, you can just keep the regularization that you had. And this quantity, the right side on the blackboard, is actually identically zero. And the average, of course, is zero. Okay. So there is nothing to say. And if now one of these two quantities is non-zero, then you can actually modify your regularized initial data set by adding a correction. So I keep un, u0n, an, a0n, and an, small an, and to it I add, in the second component, I'm adding a correction. And the correction has this form, delta n, u1n, where delta n is given by this formula. Right. And you see the reason why I'm now assuming that one of these two quantities are non-zero, because I have divided here by that. Right. So you do a slight correction, which is, I mean, it's not a slight correction because it's really a function of on S1. So you are modifying this. But the modification, you can check that the modification is, first of all, it makes sense because this quantity is non-zero. So for the regularized quantity, because this converges in L2, this quantity has to be close to C, so it cannot vanish for n large enough. And by construction, so what I did here is just to add, to do a modification precisely to ensure the conservation property, you know, the fact that this average was zero. So by construction, of course, it works. And the convergence is also okay because this quantity that was not zero, in fact, you already knew that it was converging to zero because it was converging to your exact initial data set, which has this property, right? And so this delta n can be controlled, and you get the result here. Okay, so what this means is that we can work now with a regularized initial data set. We can assume that everything is smooth, and the goal now is to prove that we have existence within a time interval which depends on natural norms of the initial data set. Okay. And so this is what I will do. Probably let me make a break now, and I will show you all these estimates and the conclusion in a real coordinates after the break. Okay. We need to derive uniform estimates for the four quantities. So you remember that in a metric we have four coefficients: capital U, capital A, capital R, nu. So these are the four main coefficients. And I already mentioned that G and H were more or less decoupled from the main equations, right? So there will be essentially four different arguments that will allow us to control these four variables, except that U and A, of course, will be treated together, and they have the same regularity, and they will come together in the main energy of the system. So I begin with the area function, and the first property that we can show using the fact that nabla r is timelike and future-oriented, the first property is that we can show that r is strictly increasing towards the future. So if you define r0 to be the minimum of the value from the initial data set, you can see immediately that r is greater than this lower bound r0 for all tau and all psi in your spacetime. So we do know that r will be increasing, and of course will not shrink to zero, and we are in the direction, we are looking at the direction that we want. Now the second property is about the gradient of the area function, and it's connected to the quantity m0 that I have introduced a little bit before. So one of the equations that we have is that r uv is equal to that quantity, E2 nu k squared over 2r cubed, and in particular this quantity is positive. And what that means, so I guess that I have not defined uv here, but I do it here. So du is d tau minus d psi, and dv is d tau plus d psi, so these are the null coordinates that I have already introduced before. And so we have here two, let me start with this one. We have two main properties. So first of all, using this equation, ruv is positive or zero, you see that the function arc tau plus or minus arc psi are strictly increasing along the lines tau plus or minus psi is constant. And these quantities depend on our functions, can be considered as function of tau minus plus psi, right? So I'm just looking at characteristics, so pretty much the same picture that we had before. So by following these characteristics, you have certain monotonicity property for the area and for these partial derivatives R sub u or R sub g, depending on which direction you look at. And this is very useful to produce a bound for this quantity. So this is the analog of the quantity I have introduced before. So the infimum of R sub u multiplied by the infimum of R sub v. So the infimum is taken on a slice, and therefore this is a function of tau. And so the statement here is that this quantity is greater than what it was at the initial time. And this quantity can also, it also give you a lower bound for the norm of the gradient of the area function. Okay, So that's clearly an important quantity that tells you that your spacetime is not degenerate in a certain sense. And the second property that we have here is that if you look at the C1 norm at the time tau, you can control it by the same norm at the time tau 0 plus tau minus tau 0 times this quantity, E2 nu in L infinity. And there are implied constants in this inequality that I somehow I didn't write the constant, but the constant depends on the initial value of the area, and it depends on the twist constant. So the twist constant is fixed, but the initial value of the area, sometimes you may want to approach the singularity, so you have to be careful to check if these estimates are uniform or not when R0 approaches 0. So the proof of that is straightforward. So the first claim, you use the fact that the product Ru Rv is R tau squared minus R psi squared. And the fact that Ru and Rv are monotonically increasing in V and U respectively. So you have this monotonicity that comes directly from the equation. And you obtain the first monotonicity property. And the second claim is also not difficult, but it's a different argument that now to control the C1 norm, you will again use the characteristics and you will follow, you will integrate along the characteristics. Right? So I don't think I need to give you the details for that. So the point is that if we go to the future, we have a good control of the area and the norm of the area, and even the C1 norm of the area is also controlled in this way. Okay. Now, how about the other quantities? So for capital U and capital A, we have an energy, which I call the conformal energy, and it's defined like this. So it's essentially the H1 norm, but it's weighted by the area, it's weighted by the function E4 times U, and it also contains a lower order term, I mean a zero order term here. Okay. So that's a quantity that you want to call the energy in conformal coordinates. And this quantity, it turns out to be bounded by the initial value times something which is going to blow up if you take tau very large. I mean, this would blow up, but at least for tau finite, this is finite, provided you have a control of the initial area and you have also a control of the C1 norm of the area. Okay. So how do you get this? So there are a couple of equations to get this. So you first use, in fact, the first remark to make is that this quantity is, in fact, exactly the quantity that you can see in the constraint equation. Okay, so I will not go back to that, but one of the two constraint equations tells you exactly that the psi derivative of R plus this correction is equal to that. Okay, I've just used it directly. Then the next step here, you go from here to here by observing that by periodicity this term is gone. So you only keep the next two terms. Then you compute the time derivative of that, right? So d d tau. What I did here is that I put a tau derivative on R. I put a tau derivative on nu tau, right? So this, the first and the third term, correspond to the differentiation of the first term here. And the other two terms are obtained by putting a tau derivative on the product here, you get two terms, and you integrate by parts by using the periodicity in S1. And you group the terms as I did here, and you see that the wave operator for R and the wave operator for nu appear. And therefore, it's tempting to use wave equations for nu and for R, and this is what we do. So you replace this by the wave equation that you had here. So you had zero order terms that I have collected in my formula. And for nu, you had quadratic terms and also zero order term. So if you do the calculation, you end up with a statement like this, where I have just kept one term. So I have basically handled this part, okay? But I have kept here, I've not tweeted yet, the term that comes from the wave operator for R, right? So this is essentially equal to that. So how do we treat this term? So we treat this term by integrating by parts in time, this term, nu tau, and eventually we will apply Grünewald's lemma. So this term here, I integrate because I want to control the energy, right? So this was the time derivative. So you integrate this inequality in time, and therefore you need to integrate this this remainder in time. And you do that by parts, so you get a term which is at tau, and a term which is at tau zero, and you get a double integral, where now the tau derivative has moved to r sub tau. Okay, but this last term can be absorbed in the energy because this term here contains, I mean this term is contained in our definition of the energy, right? You see on the top here, the conformal energy contains a zero order term. So this zero order term can be taken into this this E, and R sub tau is also the same form as this term, the C1 norm of R. Okay, and these two have the same similar structure. So there is a good energy. This good energy is not decreasing, but it's controlled by a constant, and this constant will not blow up for finite tau. Provided you can control the C1 norm of the area. Okay, so that's part of what you have to do. And now you continue with a similar analysis. So there is now a consequence of the constraint equation. So I wrote the constraint equations here. And I put them now in this form. Right. So you have actually to play with this equation with various forms, you know, and really take extract as much information as you can from this equation. So these are just the two constraint equations I stated before. And what I do now, I solve them for nu tau, nu xi in terms of the energy densities. So all these quantities are either of the form that I have in my definition of the conformal energy, or they are second order terms of the area, which will turn out to be controlled. Okay, so I solve for nu tau nu xi in terms of the rest here. But of course, when you do that, if you look at the determinant, you see that this quantity will pop up, right? So you need to control that and to bound this factor below. And that's the reason why this quantity came in our definition of the norm, I mean, or one reason. So in any case, if you do that, you will be able to express nu tau nu xi in terms of these quantities divided by this factor. And then you integrate over S1. And what you obtain is a control of the L1 norm of nu xi and the L1 norm of nu tau at arbitrary tau. And the control is in terms of the conformal energy and in terms of the C1 norm of R, right? But and also, so that's not it, because you also have terms that contain two derivatives of the area here, right? So I have to keep them, and I must take them in the L1 norm, okay, if I want to be consistent with this identity. So in this case, the implied constant depends on the initial area, and it depends on this quantity, which is essentially a lower bound for that, okay? So we have the control of the area, we have a control of the H1 norm of the essential variables of our metric, and we have also this control in W11 norm. Okay. So if you put all of that together, you are not far from having the bound. So I'm adding now a few more identities. So a higher estimate for the area function. So the second derivative in xi at any tau is controlled by the same quantity initially, plus an integral of the W11 norm of nu and the C1 norm of R, and the subnorm of E2 nu. Right. So that is this structure, and you have also an identity for arc psi tau in the L1 norm controlled by the initial value and by this. And so how do we get that? Simply, we use again integration along characteristics for the function r. So you use again this equation for this wave equation for r with zero order terms here. And you compute whatever derivative you need, you compute it out of this equation, you integrate along the characteristics, and you see what you are left with. And it turns out that what you have to control, to get a control of these second derivatives, you need a control of the L1 norm of the first derivative of nu, and a control of the C1 norm of R. Right? So I have stated, a number of properties, and there are two more properties. But these next two properties are just easy. They don't use the equations. So this tells you that the L infinity norm can be controlled by the L1 norm of the derivative plus that term. Okay. So this is pretty much direct from general coefficient, and in the same way R by again now using the equation you can also control that. Okay, so these are two easy inequalities. So the main ones are the ones that were stated before, but these are useful to somehow close the argument, because you have seen that the subnorm of nu also appears in some of the expressions, right? So you need to control that. And the C1 norm of the area also appears, so you need to make sure that you can control the C1 norm from the C1 norm of the initial data. Now you put all of that together, you do some more work, a bootstrap argument to justify everything, and you can conclude that if you have a sufficiently small interval of time in conformal coordinates, so if you work on an interval of the form tau 0 plus delta, you have uniform bounds, and the uniform bounds are stated in terms of this quantity here. So the H1 norm of U and A, the L2 norm of the time derivative, the W11 norm of nu, the L1 norm of nu tau, and these quantities here. So the area in W21 norm, the time derivative in W11, and 1 over R should be bounded, or R should be bounded below, and this gradient quantity should also be bounded below. Okay, so at this moment what we have done here, we have regularized the initial data the way I explained, and we have proven that our sequence of smooth solutions defined locally, so this sequence was bounded in these norms. Okay, but of course this is not the end of the story, because you need now to show that these smooth solutions are converging to a weak solution. Okay, and this is done with the next argument. So this compactness property will tell you that if you give me two sequences of regularized solutions in conformal coordinates defined on some time interval, where the time interval is bounded uniformly independently of the regularization parameter, and that's something I know and I can do because I have proven that these norms were bounded on a time interval which I control. So if I'm given two solutions like that, what I want to show is that I want to show when epsilon goes to zero, this has a limit, and to do that I will do the difference between two elements of the sequence and show that the difference is going to zero. Right? So I define delta u to be u epsilon 2 minus u epsilon 1, delta a in the same way, etc. And I need to show that these quantities are going to zero in the right norms. And I do it by introducing a new norm, which is not that new because it's simply built upon the previous norm. Right? So here I had u and a in H1, and now I put the difference of u and the difference of the 2a in H1. Here I have the same, but now for the difference of the time derivatives, the difference for the quantities nu tau, and here I have the difference of nu, the difference of arc psi, arc tau in W11. Now this quantity in C1, so that's again consistent what we had before, and it takes into account the fact that you don't want this to be singular, so you have also to control that, and you also take the time derivative, the difference of the time derivative of the area in C0. So this is a quantity which, if it goes to zero along a sequence, when I compare two elements of the sequence, it tells me that there is a limit and it converges to the weak solution I want. So how do I control this quantity? I could make the story short and tell you that it's similar. It is similar to the previous estimates I show you. So again, for delta small on this time interval, for delta sufficiently small, so it may need to be reduced compared to the previous argument, to just to get the bound. Now we want to control the difference, and we have that the difference at time tau 1 is controlled by possibly big constant times the difference at the initial time, and the constant, the big point is that the constant depends only on the norm of our initial data. Okay. And so if you have convergence of the initial data set in the norms that you have defined, then you have convergence at any time of your Cauchy development. Right. So this is the important property, and so in short, this follows similar lines as a derivation of the uniform bound, except that there is a lemma that is used repeatedly in the proof. The proof is more technical, much more technical than what I show you to only get the bound on the energy. And so I will tell you a little bit more about this additional lemma. Okay. So this additional lemma arises when you express these wave equations that you have here in terms of first order quantities, and you write a first order system. Okay, first order system for the u v derivatives that we have along these null coordinates. Okay, so you take these quantities which I'm calling here w plus w minus. For capital U, you do something similar for capital A, etc., for all your quantities. View it as a first order system. Then you extend your data, your solution by periodicity on the real line. And then you use, so that's a setup that you have, right? A big set of, first order system with quadratic terms. And now you apply this lemma, okay? And this lemma is a higher integrability estimate, so it will tell you that the solution is actually more regular than what you expected, or have better integrability. So it goes like this. You give me W minus W plus, the two of the quantities that I just defined. And I know that they are weak solutions. They belong only to L2. And there are weak solutions to that. So they satisfy a first order equation with a positive or negative speed, and they have some source term, and the source term is known to be in L2. Right? So that's the situation that we have. Okay? And the conclusion is that there is a quantity which is called capital N, 1 here, defined in this strange way, which is more or less decreasing, or if not decreasing, it's controlled by this quantity here. But this quantity involves norms that are controlled by our assumptions. So these are norms, if not of the initial data, at least these are norms that in the application will be known to be bounded. This quantity, in fact, is not the most important term, but it's some kind of energy that you define from W plus and W minus. So you see the structure that it has. You take W plus at theta plus, and here you take W minus at theta minus. So first you integrate with respect to theta minus from theta plus to this bound. L is any fixed quantity, so you are taking some fixed interval. I told you that you extend by periodicity, so I'm really working on the whole line here. So you fix some L, some interval minus LL, and you define these quantities here. Okay, so these are L2 integrals, if you like, which depends on time, tau, and defined in this way. And so if you look at this quantity and you compute the evolution, the time derivative of that, what you find is that there is a good bound by something that you control from your assumptions or from our bound that I have described before. But you find also a term, which is this one, which is a term of interest, and it tells you that the product of W plus and W minus is actually integrable, because I'm going to take this, integrate in time, so I know that this quantity integrated in time and in theta can be controlled by this initial data here. I should say there is some initial data contribution, and there is an integral in time of that, which again is under control. So the whole philosophy of that is that you control the product W plus W minus, which is here. Okay, but remember what this was, right? So in my application of it, W minus W plus would be these quantities here, right? So take any two of these, and what I'm telling you is that the product. So for instance, I can take the product u tau plus u xi and u tau minus u xi, which will be this quantity. I can do the same for A. Right? And so the conclusion here is that this is a quantity which has a better integrability, and that's the key to control the error terms that we have later on. Okay? So the proof of this lemma is not difficult. The first line is simply obtained by multiplying your equations. So you had two equations, one for W plus, one for W minus. And what I have done here is simply multiply by the W plus, or the modulus of W plus, the equation. And then I look at my quantity, Ni, I differentiate in time, and I just look at what I find. Right? And if you compute, you have, let me show again this expression. So you take this quantity here and you compute the tau derivative of that. Right? So this tau derivative can hit the bounds, or it can hit also the quantities inside. Okay? And so you get four terms, which are written here. And these four terms either are, when the time derivative hit the first term in the product, or the second term in the product, or one of the two bounds of the quantity. Okay, so you get these four terms, and of course, because you are computing the time derivative of W plus or W minus here and here, of course you can replace it by using the equation. So that's what I did. And then you just compute from that, right? There is nothing mysterious here. And by doing that, you find by integration of d theta multiplied by that, you produce this good term here, which is a product of W plus W minus that you are looking for. And I think there is maybe an A here, which just forget about that. It should not be there. Okay, you have lower order terms that are not very important, but the key term is this one, and this is the one that I just presented to you. So we are done with the local existence in conformal coordinates. I gave you all the estimates, and I told you that there is a compactness property that we can prove, and for this compactness property we need an additional L2 property. Which I sketch the proof of that. So now we can continue the analysis and turn our attention to real coordinates. And this is what we will get. So now we have a global geometry. Given any non-flat, weakly regular T2 symmetric initial data set, topology T3 in space with constant area, R0 positive, which we all can also assume to be future expanding, there exists a weakly regular, so this is our conclusion, there exists a weakly regular, Ricci flat, spacetime, with T2 symmetry on T3. It's a future Cauchy development of our initial dataset, and it's maximal among all weakly regular T2 symmetric developments. And importantly, so most importantly, because at this moment we had only local result, but this theorem gives you a global result. So it says that there is a unique global foliation by the level sets of the area, and the area, at this moment I'm solving towards the future, so we start from R0, and we can go up to R equals infinity. Okay, so it grows without bound, and we cover the whole foliation with this. Okay, so this is the main result that we want to achieve in this section. And the way we start here is to say that from our result in conformal coordinates, we know that the time of existence only depends on the on this initial norm, N0, that I will now restate by using these aerial coordinates. But there is a definite quantity, and if this quantity is not too small, you know that you have a solution for a time interval which is not too small. And so indeed, we can show that the aerial time of existence of the solution is bounded below by a constant that also only depends on that. Okay? But of course, that's not only what we want. We would like now to continue the solution for an arbitrary large R. So this is something we will have, provided we can prove that this natural norm does not blow up. So I have, I think, here a statement, a continuation criterion, that tells you that if you give me a solution of the aerial Einstein equations, defined in some interval of aerial time, right, R0, R1. So you assume that you have some, you have part of the foliation, and you have been able to solve for a given interval. And what you would like to know, if you can go beyond some value R star, which you have at this moment. Okay. And so according to this criterion, you can do that, you can continue the solution, provided that this norm is finite. Okay, and that's just a consequence of the results before. So more precisely, if you have such a solution defined on R0, R1, say, with regularity that you want, so I also not only put the regularity in space, but also the regularity in time. So I guess I don't need to go through this again. So you have all these spaces that that comes in the regularity conditions. So if R1 is finite, so if you have not yet able to cover the whole, get the whole foliation, and if this quantity here, is finite, or more precisely, does not blow up, so I guess R1, R star is just the same quantity. So you have some time interval in aerial time, and if this quantity remains bounded uniformly up to this time, then you can continue the solution with the same regularity. Okay. So that's what now we need to do, right? We need to control this uniformly. Control this, etc. And the norms, so of course the norms here are the same as we have seen before, but we, if you compare with conformal coordinates, of course we have also this coefficient here to be controlled, right? This conformal, the coefficient from the conformal metric that must also be controlled. So let's do that. So I will, in the estimate, I will use two notations. C will be constant that depends only on the initial norm, and C star will be constant that depends on the finite time that we would like to, to go through. The energy functional that we use now is slightly different from the previous one, or at least we have two. In fact, we have two functionals. So one is this one. So it contains only first order terms, quadratic terms. And we have this one, which also contains the lower order terms that we had before. Okay, so we need to use both to do that. You compute the time derivative of both, and you see that you get here only negative terms, right? So this is decreasing. And you compute also the epsilon k quantity, and you see that you get a decreasing quantity, right? So you have very nice energies for this system, but these energies are available in real coordinates. So later, you can already observe that. Later, I will tell you something about the time asymptotics and the completeness, geodesic completeness of these spacetimes. And let me just emphasize that the dissipation that we have here is only for UR and for A theta. So you have no U theta and AR in this dissipation. And these quantities, in some way, will control how the solution is decaying in time, right? But in certain way, two derivatives are missing here. I will return to that later, I mean, in chapter 5. The H1 energy estimate comes now quite easily and nicely because it's decreasing, so you control epsilon at any r by epsilon 0. You control epsilon k by epsilon k at the initial time. So this is direct from the formula I show you. And you have some control of these derivatives like this with some coefficient, but at this moment we don't care too much about the details of that. So at this moment, let's just keep in mind that two energies are uniformly bounded and they are decreasing, they are controlled. Now look at the initial slice. So on the initial slice, we have assumed that A is bounded, right? A is our conformal coefficient. It's uniformly bounded, it's positive, it's bounded below, above and below on the initial slice. So of course, when now you look at the initial energy, so let me show it again from here. So if you look at the energy, and if you know that A is bounded below and above, of course this is exactly the H1 norm. It can be controlled by the H1 norm, right? So this is something which is direct on the initial slice. This quantity controls the H1 norm of capital U and the H1 norm of capital A. But if I want to claim the same at any time, I need to have a control of A, an upper bound and a lower bound. Okay. So this is something we will do now. So here I just wrote that conclusion, right? See. L2 norm of these terms is controlled by the energy, and we control the energy initially. But now you would like to have that for all times, right? So if you want that for all times, you need a subnorm bound on A. And it goes like this. If you look at the equation, so A is decreasing when R increases, because this was one of our equations. It's written downstairs here. So we have that the time derivative of A, there is a minus sign, is equal to a positive quantity. So this was one of our equations in the Einstein system in a real coordinates. So you know that A is decreasing when R is increasing. So you have this bound here. But there is also another control for 1 over A. So in a sense, 1 over A cannot become too big. If you take the same equation and you divide it by, so here you put this weight, A minus 2. So this quantity becomes exactly the derivative of 1 over A. And you look at what is left. And what is left is a zero-order coefficient. But the zero-order coefficient can be simply bounded by the energy, Ek, which contains this term, but also contains first-order terms. Right? So you have a bound of this by Ek. There's an R, which is left here. And therefore, you get that. Okay, you integrate. If you integrate, this was the energy density. So if you integrate, you get the energy. And you find that 1 over R integral of 1 over A R in L1 is bounded. Okay. So you have a control. A cannot is decreasing. And A maybe cannot become too small in this sense. Okay, now we need more. So we need a statement about eta. So eta plays the same role as nu was playing before, so you expect it to be in W11, and that's indeed what you get. So the L1 norm of eta R and the L1 norm of eta theta is controlled by the energy. And there is also a pointwise estimate that we will need. So the sup of eta will be bounded by that. I'm going to show that in a minute. But first of all, let me say that the first estimate is easy by using the equation. So we had an equation for eta theta and eta r in terms of the energy. Maybe I should... okay, maybe let me return and show the equations, otherwise... okay, so... Okay, sorry for that. Maybe I should have written it then. Okay, so here we are, right? So now we are doing the analysis of this system. Okay, so I've described an energy, two energies that are monotone, and now we are looking at the constraints, and from the constraints we can get a bound of eta theta and eta r in L1. Okay, so basically that's what I wanted to do here. You know, I wanted to show you this. So you see that if you control the H1 norm of these quantities, the H1 norm here, you have a control of the L1 norm of the derivatives. Okay, that's what I was writing. So, okay, so sorry that this is not very well organized. And we continue with, sorry. Okay, so here we are. So the bound, this bound is easy, you know, from the two constraints, you get that. Now, how about this pointwise estimate? So this is more tricky, and I have one page to explain it. So let's look at it first. So it's a subnorm for eta. It's going to be bounded by the time times the initial energy. And then there will be the L1 norm of this initial value of eta. And then there will be one more term, you know, involving the time, quantity r squared, and the initial energy. Okay, so it's rather involved, but this is something that you need. And you get that by using, again, this is a... so this is what you get, again, from one of the constraints. And what I'm going to do now, so I have this statement for every theta and theta prime, right? I've just said that this is a... bounded by the integral, this is energy, so this is the integral of eta theta, and I have replaced eta theta by the energy. And so what I do here, I integrate theta, theta prime, two variables, I integrate with respect to theta prime. So if you do that, and then I divide by 2 pi, which is the length of S1, right? So you see that this term will not change, of course, because I have divided by 2 pi. This term will come here, and I write it with putting modulus outside, and this term also will not change because I have divided by 2 pi, right? So that's clear. And then you look at the last term, and you realize that the last term can be controlled by its initial value, eta bar, plus the time, the time variation from initial time to r. Right, but be careful that the absolute value should be put in this way and not inside, otherwise the argument would not work. And finally, I evaluate the second term, so this term here, by in a way where I'm now using the other constraint equation. So here I've used one for eta theta, and here I'm using the other one for eta r, which is now bounded in terms of the other energy. Okay. And there is some factor, etc. Okay, so you see the structure of the problem, and you collect all that, and you get what I said. So you control the subnorm from quantities that are under control, right? Initial data quantities, and just a function of time, right? It's an expression in terms of the time variable and the initial data. Okay, now I have other bounds that are going to possibly blow up when you reach you know, in terms of R. So the next bounds are not that uniform in a way. So what we want to conclude, we should show that there is no finite time blow up, right? So you look at your Cauchy development, and it could be that, of course, some quantities could blow up, right? Like you would see in Riccati or Berger's equation. I mean, a blow up is possible. So this is something that you want to avoid. So the first estimate that we have here is that there is a lower bound for the conformal metric coefficient A, right, which we had not yet done. So you return to the same equation, actually, that you had for A, so A sub R. But now I'm putting it in a different form. So I have divided by A in a different way, and I look at a time derivative of 1 over a squared. This bound here, so how do I get this bound? I get this bound because eta is bounded in L infinity. That's exactly what I just proved, right? So I just told you that I could control eta from the initial data and in terms of the time variable. So that's what you have here. 2 eta is bounded by some constant depending on the initial data. And the worst situation would be that it grow like R squared. And so you integrate this, and you see that A, you know, 1 over A squared can grow, but it can grow only in a way which is controlled by your time, right? It's an explicit function of time. So on a given finite time interval, this quantity is finite here. And if this is finite, it means that A cannot go to zero, right? So A is bounded below. That's what I have stated in this lemma, okay? And therefore, I can now return to the energy estimate. You have an A coefficient, but now I know that A is bounded below on my finite interval. And A was also bounded above. So I do get this, right? I have also, because the H1 norm will imply the subnorm bound, I have also that. And so we can now conclude with a good you know, a good bound in H1 for this, a good bound for A that cannot degenerate to zero or to infinity. And we have also the W11 bound for eta that we needed. But there is one more ingredient concerning the W21 bound that we need on the conformal coefficient, right? So there is still one more. This is really the last step of this series of arguments. So we need to show that we'll do that. We'll show that the r theta derivative of log A is bounded by the energy density in this way. And then we will control in L1 all the second order derivatives of this conformal coefficient. And the proof goes by differentiating this relation here that we have used a couple of times. But now you differentiate this. But when you differentiate, you get a derivative of eta, but eta theta is controlled by the energy, right? So this is not too bad, right? The energy eta theta is controlled by the energy density. So this is fine. Then you also do a similar argument for the second RR derivative here. And so you start from the same equation, but now instead of eta theta, you will see eta r to appear, but eta r again is bounded by the energy density. So this is easy. But there is a last step. If you want to control the theta derivative of A, then you have to work much more. And so it goes like this. You start again from the same equation, but now you have to differentiate this equation twice in terms of theta. And this is what I do here. So I first just write what it is, right? R is of course, independent of theta. So I have to differentiate E to eta theta theta. And I do that in a rather fancy way. I put a term like this plus a capital F. And capital F is given by that. So this is simply, if you do the algebra, you can just check that this is an identity for the second derivative of e to eta. Right? So there is nothing mysterious here. But now, to conclude, I'm going to show that this term f is bounded in L1. And if I do that, I will have the conclusion, because I can now integrate this. Of course, this is not the third derivative that I want to control. I want to control only the second derivative in theta. So you can integrate this in R, use integration by parts, and you will get the result. So if you know that this is L1 in space and time, all the rest, all the other terms will just work well with you. Right. So the main point in this argument is why this f is in L1. And so why is it so? So you look at the terms, and you see that all these terms again are connected to the null forms that we were able to control by using the higher integrability lemma. So you look at the equation for eta, you look at this term, and you see that all the terms that will appear are terms of this form. So they are products of a term like this, a term like that, and we have been able to establish a good higher integrability property for these terms. So that's this is the end of the argument to prove the global existence in aerial coordinates for weakly regular spacetimes. I just restated the result here. So we have a unique global weak solution defined now on the whole interval. We can go to plus infinity. We have the regularity conditions that we expected. And in fact, we not only we have the regularities that we put in our definition, but we have some additional regularity, especially continuity in time, that came from solving the Einstein equations, even though it was not required to express the Einstein equation in a weak sense. That's something we had done before. Okay, so we are close to the end for this chapter. I have a couple of additional properties which I will go through. So I have a lemma here that explains how you get the continuity in time, because this is something that you have to prove that by using the fact that you are solving equations. So we have wave equations on a metric, and the metric has a regularity determined by this coefficient rho, which is only W21, right? So you have to check that the time continuity is indeed under this regularity assumption. So this is addressed by this general lemma that says that if you have solutions with this regularity in space, H1, L2, but for which you have no information in time, and they are so this function is a solution of a wave equation with a coefficient, a metric with this low regularity like this, and a source which is L2, then you can prove that this solution can be regarded as a limit of smooth solutions, and therefore will acquire the time regularity that you have for these smooth solutions, and therefore you will be able to conclude not only the regularity H1, L2 in space, but you will have this additional regularity in time, okay? By an argument that says that you can approach these solutions by more regular, I mean Lipschitz continuous solutions. Okay, so maybe let me skip that. These are in the notes. So if you want, you can go through the proof. And so when we apply this argument to our system, what we do, we look at the Cauchy space, which I have done a couple of times, and we observe that in conformal coordinate, this coefficient rho in the metric, of course, it's just one, so there is no issue about regularity of it. But in a real coordinate, this rho is what I have also denoted by A minus 1. And we have just proven, I mean, this was the last few slices, we have just proven that A is W21. Okay, so, and in fact, for the lemma, we need C1 as a regularity, so we do have the regularities that we need in order to prove these continuity properties. And there was also an issue of the source terms to be L2, and this came again from the higher integrability lemma. So not only this is useful to prove the continuity in time, but in fact, this argument also comes when you want to show this property, which I mentioned before. But in fact, I didn't give the whole argument. So the regularity of the metric coefficients does not change if you change the coordinates from conformal to areal or from areal to conformal coordinates. Okay. And so to check that, you have to use this lemma. And I have to make even things more clear. I have here two propositions saying that if you have a weakly regular Ricci flat but non-flat T2 symmetric spacetime with admissible conformal coordinates, then we can prove the existence of an areal coordinate system which is W21 compatible. Right. And so again, I mean, this is something I said earlier, but I want to repeat this with a formal statement here. So if you look at the space, the manifold, which has a C-infinity structure, which is compatible with this chart that you are giving, right, to describe your space, then what you can see that these are admissible coordinates for this manifold, and Einstein equations hold in areal coordinates. And you have a similar results where you reverse the role of areal and conformal coordinates. Okay, so there is also a statement about geometric uniqueness, which maybe I should emphasize also here. So this is just a formal definition to more precisely specify what we are talking about here. So we have a weakly regular T2 symmetric initial data set as our data, and what we call a weakly regular T2 symmetric future development is a weakly regular T2 symmetric Lorentzian manifold. I mean, all of that has been defined carefully before, together with a smooth embedding onto one of the hypersurfaces of the foliation, which is also part, this foliation is part of our definition of a Lorentzian manifold with T2 symmetry, and of course we assume that HK coincide with a prescribed, the prescribed HK coincide with induced metric and the second fundamental form on this slice, and that the image phi of sigma coincide with a past boundary of M. Right. So the only thing new here is that I want to emphasize the word future to make the next statement completely clear. And so here is a statement. We have a development will be said to be a proper extension of another development if there exists a C1 isometric embedding into a proper subset of what you have, right? So what I'm discussing here is a possibility to extend your spacetime beyond the region that you have built. And the statement that I will make in a second is that we have constructed the maximal extension of our spacetime. So a maximal extension, maximal development, is a development which has no proper extension. And so now this is the result, the uniqueness results that you can prove with these definitions is that given any initial data set with weak regularity, there exists a weakly regular T2 symmetric future development defined for all r bigger than your initial value. And so this the fact here is that the statement here is that this development is unique up to C1 diffeomorphisms and is maximal in this sense. And therefore it coincides with spacetime that we have just constructed. So in other words, what I'm saying here is that even though we are working with a rather low regularity condition, we can still prove a uniqueness statement formulated in this way. So let me conclude for today by so the references. I can mention, of course, there was a work of Vince Moncrief and Berger and other people in a regular case. So if you assume regularity, I mean C2 regularity, a lot of analysis that you can do. And now let me mention what we'll be doing next, right? So next Friday, what I will start will be the discussion of fluids, right? Compressible fluids. So basically all the techniques that have been presented here are robust. So even though I have done it in a Ricci, presented them in a Ricci flat case, they are very robust. All the definition and convergence arguments, etc. All these arguments can work if now you have also the matter and especially a compressible fluid in the picture, and the compressible fluid will prevent you to construct spacetimes with high regularity. There is a limited regularity which is implied by the presence of shocks of a fluid. So this is something we will discuss next time, and I will show you the analysis, techniques that allow you to prove the existence of self-gravitating fluids. And next, so this will be the chapter 4, and maybe the Friday after that, we will look at the global geometry, and you will see that there are some results that we can prove, completeness, and some information about the global dynamics. But in fact, there are still open problems, even in the Ricci flat category, and even more if you have the fluid, there are a lot of open problems, open questions for these spacetimes. Okay, thank you.